Welcome back to Science in Real Life. I'm Molly, and I'm in the ridiculously beautiful Pfizer lab at the New York Botanical Garden. Check out this lab, though. And I'm here with a super special guest. This is Gregory Plunkett, and he's the director of the Garden's Coleman Program for Molecular Systematics. Thanks for having us, Greg.
Oh, it's wonderful to have you, Molly.
Okay, before we jump in, can you tell us a little bit about molecular systematics?
So the systematics part is really what we call biodiversity sciences. It's trying to understand the huge number of species out there. So in terms of described species, there's about 1.6 million species. And we think that there's up to 100 million species out there, so a lot more to discover. And then the molecular part is to try to use DNA-based characters to look at how all these different organisms are related through both space and time.
If we want to analyze a specific gene sequence in our molecular systematics research,
we first have to isolate the genes we want to study from the whole genome and amplify them to a quantity that can be sequenced. This isolation and amplification is accomplished by PCR, the Polymerase Chain Reaction, ubiquitous molecular biology experiment, and kryptonite of intro bio students everywhere, except for Clark Kent, whose kryptonite was actual kryptonite.
Wait, did that not sound impressive enough? Let me say it again. PCR allows scientists to isolate a specific piece of DNA and make millions and millions of copies.
So we're going to be doing a PCR reaction in the lab today, and this is going to be an experiment based on a group of plants that I work on that grow in the high Andes, in the very high mountain ranges in South America, and they're in the carrot family.
Greg mentioned using DNA-based characters to study molecular systematics. This means we're looking for variation in DNA sequences between species, which we can use to figure out how those species are related to one another. We'll talk a lot more about this in our next episode, but for now,
what gene will we be amplifying with PCR today?
Well, Molly, in fact, we're not going to be looking at a gene at all. We're going to be amplifying a spacer region of DNA between two genes from the chloroplast genome. And the reason we're doing that is that the species that we're looking at today are very closely related, and so their genomes are going to be very similar. And we need to find a region that's accumulating mutations much more rapidly than a gene would find.
All right, let's get started with the PCR.
Great.
We'll be doing PCR on 8 species from the carrot family. And Greg extracted the DNA from these plants just like we extracted DNA from Arabidopsis plants in the last episodes.
We're going to take these 8 samples, and we're going to pipette 2 microliters of each DNA into these small tubes here. That's where our reactions will take place. So this is the original copy, and then we'll have the new copy through PCR.
And except for the DNA, all of the ingredients in the PCR reaction are the same for all the samples, so we can make a master mix, which also happens to be my DJ name.
Okay, so in PCR amplification, we're making new copies of DNA from this original DNA template. So the first thing we need are the building blocks of DNA, and those are the nucleotides. So we're going to take this tube of nucleotides, and we're going to add it into the master mix.
And then we need the building machine that can string all of these nucleotides together in the correct order and bind them together to make the next strand of DNA. The machinery that does that is called TAC polymerase, and it's an enzyme that can bind the nucleotides together.
And the next ingredient are the two primers.
So the primers are little bits of DNA that are complementary to either end of the gene, and so the TAC knows to only build the new DNA in between those two.
So the primers are how we isolate the specific region of DNA that we want to amplify from the whole genome.
We're just going to shake it up on the vortex. We're ready to put the master mix into the individual tubes where our genomic DNA is already.
Now we're ready to actually run the PCR reaction, and we'll be using a thermocycler to do that.
And it's really just a precision machine that allows us to place the samples into a series of wells, and the machine goes from different temperatures very quickly and very precisely. So each PCR protocol includes 3 different steps. The first step is an almost boiling at 94 degrees Celsius that allows the original template DNA to go from double-stranded to single-stranded.
The second step is much cooler temperature, and this is an optimal temperature for those two primers to anneal to the template DNA to tell the TAC where to build the DNA.
And then the third stage is 70 degrees Celsius, and this allows the TAC DNA polymerase to extend the strand. It's the optimal temperature for the enzyme.
And then we're going to repeat these 3 steps many, many times. At each repeat, we're doubling the number of DNA strands. This allows for an exponential increase in the copies of our DNA, so that's why we're left with millions and millions once the PCR reaction is done.
At the end of the PCR reaction, each tube is full of millions of copies of the chloroplast spacer region that's been isolated from a single species' DNA.
Our PCR reaction is done, but before we spend the money on sequencing the PCR product, we want to make sure that the reaction actually worked. So we're going to visualize the DNA in the PCR tubes before we send them out to the sequencing facility.
We do this using gel electrophoresis. First, we pour a gel into a mold that leaves little wells for our PCR product to sit in. We load just a teeny bit of our PCR product into the wells and then pass electricity through the gel. This will make the DNA, which is negatively charged, move into the gel towards the positive charge. Then we stain the gel with a dye that makes the DNA light up under UV light.
And what we can see is that all the samples worked well. The first lane is what we call a DNA standard ladder, a predetermined number and quantity of different sequences so we can determine how long the PCR products were from our reaction. There are two different length variations of the same DNA sequence region. So already we're seeing some variation across different species.
If you're wondering why we did this PCR reaction, tune in next time to learn about how we analyze the DNA sequences from our PCR products to understand the tree of life.